Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the tutorial session for today. We are doing open data with the Elastic Stack. This session is going to last until 12:20, so we're in for a good time. I'd like to welcome, I've forgotten which way around it's going to go, Josh?
He's Mark, I'm Josh.
Ah, wrong way around already.
No, wait, it's the other way. Sorry. I'm nervous.
That's
Josh.
Guys.
I'm Mark. Evan Costello, as you'll probably come to know us. Thank you. Thanks for everyone for showing up. It's great to be here, both as speakers. Josh spoke yesterday. He spoke about PingBeat, which is a cool little thing we might get into later. I'm obviously speaking now. We're also sponsoring, so thanks to Linux Australia for accepting our money and letting us do that. That's really awesome. So today we are here to talk about open data with the Elastic Stack. The talk actually was titled The ELK Stack, but we've since had some direction from marketing that's to be called The Elastic Stack, so there's a slight change there. As mentioned, my name is Mark. That's my Twitter handle there. I was a sysadmin. I now do a whole bunch of things, not limited to running community in the ANZ region for Elastic, support, and don't hate me, I also do a little bit of pre-sales. I have been using Linux for a long time. I don't know how long, I haven't really kept count. This is actually my only third LCA. Last year at Auckland, I spoke about using the ELK stack for monitoring logs. So maybe next year I'll be a keynote at this rate, but don't quote me on that. This guy here, I'll let him introduce himself.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Yeah, so I'm Josh. I did a talk earlier this week on PingBeat. I'm based in Canberra. I'm an ex-sysadmin, I guess. I've been using Linux for a fair while. You might hate me and you can boo. I used to use Gentoo Linux. I actually convinced the workplace to run a Gentoo HPC system. It worked really well, actually. Nowadays I'm just a Fedora guy. But yeah, so hello.
In your spare time, Josh is a astrophysicist, or he was an astrophysicist.
Was, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Yep.
So he's really smart. I'm not that smart. I never went to uni. School of hard knocks. Okay, so has everyone got the materials? There's a USB stick that was passed around. There's some config files. There's some tidy zips of it, the various products that we're using. There's one up the back there that needs one. Feel free to keep the sticks. We bought 10. We don't really need them. They're like cheapos from Officeworks. They're totally legit. There's nothing bad on them either. Okay, so today this is what we're going to talk about. Memes, essentially. There's a lot of those, thanks to our meme master here. He actually has a specific channel for GIFs, which is kind of hilarious. So we're going to do a brief intro of the various products, Elasticsearch, Logstash, and Kibana. We're going to go through a couple of different data sets. We'll teach you how to process those through Logstash, which is the ingestion engine, into Elasticsearch, which is the storage and the analysis engine, and then we'll build some pretty stuff with Kibana. We also have, because it's the cool thing to do, drones to give away, and there's two prizes. There's an awesome prize and then a awesome, but not as awesome prize, because it doesn't have a JB Hi-Fi gift voucher. We'll get to that a little bit later, but we want you to be able to sort of use the products in a basic fashion, go away, build something really cool, come back and show us, and you can win stuff. There is some swag up in the back there, too, for those that missed out. There are some more batteries, so don't be too worried. So this is the goal. So I've been playing around with some open data sets because open data is interesting and it's open, like it's easily accessible. And the cool thing about it is you can tell different stories. So, you know, when I load and process a data set, I'll build something which is going to be totally different to, you know, someone like Brad up in the back here or Jules or, you know, someone. You know, each and every story that you tell with a data set is unique. So, you know, let's play with some real data and figure out some stuff. So prerequisites, do we all have Java installed? Because Elasticsearch and Logstash are Java-based. Don't laugh. That's totally legit, man.
You just need the OpenJDK. Your distro should have it. Java 7, Java 8, either of them. That'll work.
We have included Taji zips of Elasticsearch, Logstash, Kibana. Kibana is OS-dependent, so there's a Mac version and just a generic Linux one. The other, Logstash and Elasticsearch, they're just, it doesn't matter, it's agnostic. You can just go here if you want to download Debs, RPMs. We also have repos if you want to install it that way, if you've got a Docker image or a Vagrant machine or whatever you use. That is totally wrong. I was very optimistic when I wrote that. That's where you can download all the configs from today as well, if you want to play around with it a little bit later. So if you just extract things into a directory wherever you want to put it, and then we can get started. But before we do that, let's talk a little about what open data is, right? Essentially, it's free data. You're able to redistribute it. You can do whatever you want with it. There's no copyright restrictions. So you don't have to worry about getting permission to use it because it's been released with the view of, you know, it's free. We kind of had a bit of a line about using our products to democratize data. We use that in a way that, you know, by pushing data into Elasticsearch and using a visualization tool like Kibana, it's instead of having to deal with, you know, APIs and JSON or, you know, some sort of library, you actually get a nice graphical interface. You know, you remove the need for, you know, having too much technical knowledge, but having a lower level of technical knowledge. So it's about democratizing that data. So, you know, using Kibana and being able to take this data stack, you can basically put Kibana up somewhere, put the data into Elasticsearch, and let your users just do cool things with it. We are big believers in open, just in general. My background is obviously in open source, so I'm with Josh. We are an open source company, even though we do sell some stuff on the side. We believe that, you know, when things are free, everybody wins. You know, when we're talking about specifically open data, you know, there was a recent release by The Guardian of some politician expense data. That was really interesting. And that's, you can take that and you can push back on your politician and go, hey, why did you spend $5,000 on a helicopter ride? Right? You can do some really cool things. You know, you can say, well, how can I take this data, mash it up, you know, analyze it in a different way, merge it with other existing data, and do some correlations, and just sort of see, well, you know, what are some things that you previously wouldn't have known about a data set? So I had a talk to, where was it? I'm just trying to remember. It was another conference. I was talking to someone that does, a journalist that does some work for the Guardian, amongst other things. And he said that they took a whole bunch of US open source data about political donations and the votes that those politicians then made, you know, and the relationships between, you know, someone from sponsoring from like Monsanto to this person, and then would that weigh, you know, the votes on copyright or IP specifically, I suppose, for Monsanto, because apparently you can IP seeds. And he said what he found was interesting, that those payments didn't actually influence the vote, which kind of sounds really weird, but the data backed him up. And, you know, open data is cool because, you know, you can just play around with it. You know, you can do weird stuff. You can, you know, analyze a couple of weird data sets, as we'll see. I won't spoil it. And you know, sometimes you've just got an interest in something. You know, you may have an interest in koala populations. You might have an interest in, I don't know, what's an interesting data set? I mean, that one's not really interesting. But, I mean, the point is that, you know, by having open data, you can take an interest and turn that into something that's actually analyzed, and it's available for greater, it's democratized, that's what I'm trying to say. So this is the best possible way of dealing with open data. We find something that's cool. data.org.au is a really, really cool place to start. There are some state ones as well. You find some data, you download it, you do stuff, and then you come out with some cool thing at the end. This doesn't always work. This is CS, right? So this is the dream. Thank you, Josh, for your meme here. If you do this and it works, it is this. Yeah? A unicorn shirt, optional, but I think it helps. But what really actually happens is this. You know, those dots transform into something like this, you know. Open data is open, it's available. Doesn't mean it's normalized.
So everyone see the recursive trick in there? Yeah, very good. Yeah, several iterations.
You can spend a fair bit of time playing around with open data and trying to, you know, convert things and make sure it's all normalized so that you can then process it and do stuff with it. Even if things that's available via the APIs, you know, from data.gov.au, I found it's not entirely consistent. And that's really painful to have to deal with. And you can spend a fair bit of time trying to you know, write a specific query against the API to get specifically exactly what you want, and it sucks. You know, even though the data's there, doesn't mean it's always in the best possible format. And then, yeah, that's the reality. That's what you do.
It's just too much sometimes.
It's way too much. Okay, so we would like to think we have the tools to help stop this. Has anyone used Elasticsearch, Logstash, Kibana, any of our products, other products? Yeah, okay. Does anyone have absolutely no idea who we are and what we're talking about? Okay, all right, yeah. No, you can't say that. So we have this suite of tools, and the Elasticsearch, Logstash, Kibana, ELK, that's where the traditional name came from. So Elasticsearch is written in Java. It is entirely open source, so you can jump onto our GitHub repo, you can pull it down, you can do whatever crazy stuff you want to do with it. It's Apache licensed. But essentially, it's a JSON-based distributed search engine. Is anyone familiar with, if I say Lucene, does anyone know what I'm talking about? A couple of people? Okay. So Elasticsearch is actually based on Lucene. Lucene isn't distributed. It is a single instance, and then if it dies, you don't have the data. Elasticsearch, the cool thing about Elasticsearch is we've taken Lucene, and we meaning the royal we, because I certainly didn't do it. We've taken Lucene, and then we've turned it into a distributed engine. So you have a whole bunch of these Lucene instances, which Elasticsearch manages, and you can, it's all API driven. And it's all JSON-based, as I mentioned. So you have a cluster of these, and if you lose one, it's okay, because Elasticsearch, you know, it shards the data and distributes it, and we have redundancy and all these sorts of cool things. Because it's essentially a search engine underneath the hood, we can also, you know, once we find things, we say, well, you know, give me a list of all of the items that contain this value or this field, and on top of that, we can do some really cool and powerful analytics. We'll play around with some of those with Kibana specifically, but all Kibana's doing is just running these same analytics via the APIs. So we'll show you some cool tricks there. Logstash is also, it's written in Ruby, and we turned it into Java. It's kind of like, I don't want to say ETL tool, but that's kind of what it is, right? It's Apache license as well, up on the website. The way that it works is it's kind of in three stages. You have an input, and then a filter, and then an output. So an input, you can obviously push data in. So you can have TCP sockets, or TCP ports, you can have email accounts, you can do IRC, you can do file. What are some other cool things you can do? You can actually take data out of Elasticsearch and back into Logstash.
Yeah, it's much more than just log collection nowadays. It can do, yeah. Like, for example, it can poll another REST server and grab whatever the results of that server reports back. Or you can have it listening, and you can have your like legacy application send a blob of data to Logstash, and it will index that or send it off wherever you want. So it has a lot of inputs. It has JDBC, so it can hook into a lot of things. The best way to look at it is it's sort of like this thing which just sits there and it takes something, it can do some mangling to it and throw it out somewhere else. It's sort of like a data shipper nowadays, more than just a log tool sort of thing.
Yeah, so and the second stage after you've retrieved the data from somewhere is to use a filter. Filters are not mandatory. If you know your data's in a perfect format, which it's probably never going to be in, you can just skip the filters. But some of the filters you can do, there's one called grok. Does anyone know what grok, the grok reference? Yeah? No one else knows it. Wow, does no one read sci-fi these days? It's not that old. It's from the golden age of science fiction. Yeah, Heinlein, yeah, Stranger from a Strange Land. It's a really awesome book. You should read it. It messed with my head when I first read it.
I think it still messes with your head.
Sorry?
I think it still messes
with
your head.
It does. So grok is like regex without having to deal with regex. It's basically taking patterns and defining that as, you know, you build a pattern, you give it a name, and then you can just keep reusing that again and again and again. So it, you can have that USB stick. It's a present. That's for answering that question. Thank you. There's other ones like normalizing date filters, for example, because in our land, everything works on UTC, because UTC is an actual standard, so we love using ISO 8601. You can do other things like, you know, we won't touch on it today, but you can take an IP, for example, look it up in a MaxMine GeoIP database, so you get back coordinates, and so you can map that on a map, funnily enough. And you can see, you know, where the data's coming from or going to. There's a Ruby one, so you can write some custom Ruby code to do funky stuff. There's heaps. There's heaps and heaps and heaps. I can't remember the numbers. But anyway, once you've done your input, you've moved on to your filter, you've done whatever stuff you want to do, you've enhanced it, you need to do something with it. It needs to go somewhere. It can't just exist in nowhere. And so some of the outputs, you can actually send it back to a file if you really want. You can send an email. You can push it into Elasticsearch, you can send stuff into Graphite or Influx because it's compatible. You can send it to, I don't think you can do tweets. Tweets are only input. You can send it out to another HTTP endpoint, for example. So you can send a call to PagerDuty. So you can see my sysadmin background here. There's a whole bunch. So when you sort of count the inputs, the filters, and the outputs, the ones that we officially support, there's around about 200, over 200, actually. Then there's a whole bunch of community ones. You can build your own. It's very, very simple. And so I don't know how many there are because we don't track them, but there is heaps and heaps and heaps.
And I'll just add that Logstash also has a bit of like conditional processing in it. So you can be a bit selective and say, okay, these logs need to go off to this server on these logs or this data needs to go off to this server. So you can actually choose where your outputs are. You can also choose that filtering stuff which we were talking about. You can choose which filters apply to which data. So you can be very, you can have this like mass chaotic potentially like config which is processing a whole bunch of different types of data and doing very selective things with it.
Once we've dealt with the data and we've pushed it into, in this case, we're going into Elasticsearch, you want to be able to do something with it. I mean, some people are at home with JSON and APIs, you know, on a CLI or through a library. That's not really me. I'm really lazy. I like, you know, nice point-and-clicky interfaces. Kibana is written in Node.js, I think, these days. We're up to version 4 with Kibana. We actually just had a release yesterday morning, but we didn't manage to update the files in time, so we're using a slightly older version. It won't impact anything, though. Kibana's really cool. It's, you know, things like, I mean, you can do all the boring stuff like pie graphs and line graphs and various charts. You can do maps. You can do all sorts of other things. You can also build plugins for Kibana, so you can actually build a specific visualization that you want to play around with. So we've had people build like things like stoplights just to sort of show a high-level status. There was one that one of the Kibana devs knocked up, which is like a tag cloud for the blog sort of things that you see. There's one that we've just recently released called Time Lion, but it's spelled Time Lion as in the animal. And it's sort of an experimental thing that we've, the code's available, and we're sort of working through that with blog posts just to give people an idea of how to build specific plugins or custom plugins, and then also the, some of the functionality that you can do with them. So that's sort of a quick rundown of the tools that we'll be specifically using today. Really quickly, Josh did a talk yesterday on ping beats. Ping beats are these little things written in Go that do specific things. There's one called file beat, which reads files and sends them to Logstash or Elasticsearch. Ping beat like runs pings and then collects that information, pushes it into Elasticsearch. There's a whole bunch of other ones that we won't touch on, but they're completely open source again, Apache licensed. That's why we went from ELK to the Elastic Stack, because PELK or KELP, although KELP's pretty cool, but I mean, it just doesn't have the same ring, you know. So we're going to do a bit of hands-on stuff. Remember where we're going. So we're just going to, we've got, this is what you should see. I think I included the README as well because, you know, everyone loves Markdown. So to start Elasticsearch, it's pretty simple. It's that simple, right? I mean, you're actually up and running now. So you want to point out a few
things? I was just going to say, does everyone see, you might have something different here.
Yep.
Does anyone see any kind of trend? If you go and look at the other person next to you, you might see it's a particular type of superhero universe. Mm. So yeah, so don't mind that. That's just an automatic name, which is designed just to identify the node.
Yep. You can totally set that as well. So you can call it, you know, my node one. Don't call it my node one, that's a terrible name. There's actually a big list of Marvel characters. You can totally modify that file, and so when you restart Elasticsearch, it'll pick it at random. We've had people submit, so that's Marvel characters. We've had DC characters. We've actually had some really weird person submit a bunch of porn stars, which we sort of went, no, that's not cool.
So if anyone's not seeing this, let me know. I'll come
yes,
and have a
Josh
look.
Josh is our roaming helper. Thank you,
yep,
Josh.
I'm roaming helper today.
So a couple of other things I'll point out. We have, so this is all in, right. So here, this tells you what interface Elasticsearch is listening on. By default, in Elasticsearch 2, for any older users, the 1 series users, by 2, we only listen to localhost. So loopback, you can change that. We're not going to today, but it's completely configurable. You can tell it to listen to all addresses or, you know, only public ones. You can tell it to listen to IPv6 and 4 and whatever you want to do. So a couple of, two last things. We've got this publish address on 9300, and then we also have this address down here of 9200. So 9200 is the HTTP port, so that's the one we'll be dealing with in the most cases. So you can just use curl to access that. 9300 is what an Elasticsearch cluster, so more than one node for it to be a real cluster. It talks to other nodes on 9300. It's a custom binary protocol. You can read all about it in the source code if you really want. If you run curl against that, it'll go, no, this isn't a HTTP port. These are customizable again, but I mean, we're not going to get into that. That's probably really hard to see. So, curl. Actually, sorry, I'm going to move that up to there. So here, we can see this name, forgotten one. Can everyone see that okay? Do you want me to make it a bit larger? I'll make it larger anyway. That's the name that corresponds to the one in the log that we saw earlier. You can see things like, obviously, the version number. There's a build hash if you're really interested in that. You've got the Lucene version, because Lucene, you know, keeps doing cool stuff, so we keep importing that or using that cool stuff in Elasticsearch. So at this point, Elasticsearch is all up and live. You should get a 200. This is a 200 response because we use standard HTTP response codes. Did anyone not see this? Or this? Please yell out, my lovely assistant here. I won't launch these. So the next thing we're going to... Oh, no, wait, I've gone ahead of myself, sorry. Next up is Logstash. So I'm not in the right place.
So, yeah, we're going to need a couple of terminals for this. So you might want to leave Elasticsearch running in the background, fire up a new terminal or tab or whatever you're using, and play around in that.
So a couple of things I'll point out here, because... like I was talking about earlier, the Logstash has a concept of inputs, filters, and outputs. You can totally just start Logstash, and it can take a little while to start up, which sucks. That's just a JVM heating up, I suppose. But you know, it goes, hey, you can't really run Logstash without giving it something to do, right? Because you need to be able to say, hey, look, you expect this data coming in, do this with it, and then do something with it after that. So there's a couple of examples here of using some really, really basic configs. So this is obviously standard in, so it actually takes whatever you type in to the console. And here, this is an empty filter, but I've put it in just to, you know, so you're used to the concept. It's input, filter, output, and then we just spit it to standard out. So, oops. It doesn't really matter. So here I've got spaces in between things, but it doesn't really matter. You may not be able to copy things. I didn't give a copy. Oh, sorry, I forgot to put a PDF of the slides in there. I'll put a PDF of the slides with the rest of the files. You may not be able to copy them out because the backticks can be a little bit painful sometimes. Oh, yeah, as my little speaker notes say, we have apt and yum repos for this, so you don't actually have to run it this way. So if we just run that, we wait for it to start up again. Oh, that's terrible. Maybe I do need these spaces here.
Actually, I see what we did.
What did I not
do? Did everyone see what we did wrong?
No, I can't.
We're really bad. We didn't wrap those in inputs and outputs, so yeah.
Oh, wow, that's really bad. I get paid for this stuff.
Not anymore.
So this is actually what it should look like. How do we miss that? Woo! Yep. That's actually what it should look like. So, hang on. I'll copy here. Can everyone still see that or not? But when it's actually done right, we have an input with the input type and an output with the output type. Sorry? Yeah.
So, yeah.
Do you want a job? Because... okay, so this is what you'll actually see. You'll say, hey, look, I've started up, and it'll just sit there, right? Because we've said we want standard in, so it's actually waiting to accept something via standard in. So you type whatever. You can type something, you can paste it in, and because we're just doing standard out without actually doing anything apart from spitting it out, you can see the message that comes out is you've got a timestamp because we associate everything with a time. That's the name of my machine because I'm a Futurama fan, and then the message. That's proof of concept, right? I mean, that works. There we go. Bit of live magic.
Everyone else built to run Logstash and have it there. Just copy and paste some text in there, see what it does. Some multi-line text, do something else, some numbers, whatever you want. Just type some stuff in there. Have a play around.
And then you just control C to close it down. So that was interesting. It's kind of pretty useless though. So what we'll actually do is we'll add this thing in. You can actually define codecs. So we talked about an input, a filter, and an output, but there's also a concept of codecs, which kind of don't really sit in any one of those particular things, because you can use the codecs across anything. Ruby debug, and I can't spell again. So here, we're just running the same thing, right? It's the same input standard in, no filter, output standard out, but we're saying, with the output, we want to use this Ruby debug codec. And basically what that means is that if we post in that what I typed earlier, it does this, which is marvelous, right? It's pretty basic. But it gives you a bit of an idea of, you know, how to do some really basic things with Logstash. You can put a codec in a filter, in an input. Can you use codecs in filters? I can't remember. I don't think so. There's a whole bunch of different codecs for, you know, there's NetFlow codecs, there's Ceph codecs, there's various JSON ones. There's a whole bunch of other different ones, codecs you can play around with.
Yeah, so these codecs are really nice for, like, you know, formatting your data, or if you know the input is in a particular format, you can define that the codec for that format. For the output, you can essentially redefine the data into a specific format. The nice one about this Ruby debug, why we're showing it, is because maybe later on when you guys are playing, it gives you this nice structured output which allows you to see exactly what's happening. And as you add filters and things like that, which maybe create some extra fields in there, you'll see some more data and some interesting stuff happening. So.
Yeah, this standard, and just to elaborate, this standard out with the codec Ruby debug is really, really useful for actual debugging and finding out why the message that you're dealing with isn't in the format, the outgoing format that you expect. So I use this type of, you know, this dash E, because dash E means, you know, read the config from here. The input standard in, I use this sort of thing for debugging a lot, especially when I'm first playing around with data, because it gives you, you know, immediate response. You don't have to load it up, put it into Elasticsearch, go into Kibana and go, why isn't this working? If you look in the get started directory, you'll see exactly what we typed earlier with the dash E with the codec Ruby debug and then without it. So you can actually, instead of doing dash E, you go dash F, get started, standard in, standard out. I hope I did these config files right. No, I didn't. Oh, that is just terrible.
Yeah, we're gonna.
Anyway,
over into the stock in the corner.
Lucky we both reviewed them, hey? All right, anyway. So that's how you, That is how you basically, you know, dash F, you can do a specific config file, you can do it like a conf.d directory, so a whole bunch of configurations. So the way that it works is if you've got a directory, it'll just concatenate everything. So Josh mentioned conditionals before. So if you have a whole bunch of different filters and inputs and outputs and you don't use the conditionals, you can actually have things stepping on each other. That's a bit more advanced. It's up on the website. This is Kibana. Kibana's really, really simple as well. So, wait, where am I?
Yeah, so again, we're going to need another terminal. So keep Logstash, well, you don't have to keep Logstash running. Keep Elasticsearch running. So leave that terminal open. You can probably just reuse the Logstash terminal for now. Otherwise, just fire up another one.
And because Elasticsearch is still running, we all left it running, right? If you didn't, this won't really work. Or it'll start and it'll complain. So here you can just see, you know, there's a whole bunch of plugins that we've shipped by default around specific visualizations, and we'll touch on those later. You can see down the bottom here, you know, we're running at localhost 5601. And you can see here we've got the Elasticsearch plugin. Because this is a brand new installation, it says, you know, we store Kibana information in Elasticsearch because it's a data store and you know, dog fooding and all that. So it says here, you know, no existing Kibana index, and it creates it, and then it goes, hey, everything's cool. Everything's up and running. This is where we expect to be. We have.
Let me know if you don't get something like that.
We didn't help. Used to. We never had repos for Kibana. We just released them with 4.4. So you can jump on the website and download Debs and RPMs if you want as well. So everyone up to this point. I know we're going. It kind of feels like we're going slow, but it's worth it. Sorry. Awesome. Okay. So that was all kind of a little bit boring. You know, everyone can run a command in a shell and do some really basic things like completely scrub the configs. Or you can get them right, in which case you can grab a prize from the table. So now we're actually going to do something interesting, and we're going to process some data sets. And this is you know, a nice example of what we've already talked about 100 times. You know, we use Logstash to read the data, we push it into the Elasticsearch, and we read it out with Kibana. And we can build all sorts of cool stuff with Kibana. So this is the first data set. And I'll let my lovely assistant talk about it. Thanks,
right,
Josh.
All right, cool. So everyone knows about this is probably quite old. Like, you know, in Australia we're really good. We've got a national public toilet map. Everyone knows about this. So it's like 16,000 around that toilets in there, and has information about like their geolocation, like lat long coordinates. It has like a description, you know, what facilities are available. And the reason we're going to use this data is because of just that. It has a lot of different data types in it. It has some numbers, it has some strings, it has some lat long, and so we really get to see some of the power of sticking that data in Elasticsearch and having some nice visualizations. It's a really cool data set. The other thing is that, you know, a lot of people use us for logging sort of solutions. This is essentially not logs. This is just data. It's static. It has no need for a timestamp or anything like that. So you can just stick a static data set in there and do some visualization on it. So that's kind of a cool feature as well.
Just gonna hold the mic for you.
Oh, that's all right.
When you type.
Yeah, no, that's cool. So basically, this is the public toilet map. It looks really pretty. Maybe we can try and create something like that. It might not be as good, but you know, that's our goal for today. We're going to try and create something similar to this. We're not going to have social media like buttons and things like that, unfortunately, but that's all cool. Maybe not a feedback thing, so yeah. But so some other things. Just out of interest, that's the nearest public toilet if anyone needs the toilet. So that's the closest one there, and it's it's available from 6 a.m. to 9 p.m. So there's plenty of time. Go check it out while you're here. So cool. So that's what this. So and, you know, that's what we want to create. We want to create something really nice, a nice, pretty visual representation of this data. But what we're actually going to see of the actual data is this, and that's kind of ugly. That's what we see, you know, as a developer, and that's what, you know, somebody will come to you and say, I want this. I want you to make this. Into this, and you're like, what? You know, so yeah, how do I do that? But you know, if you look at that carefully, like you can see, you know, there are some particular elements there. You know, it's a CSV, it's just fields, you know, field values. So you can see some things like a URL, like a name, some true, some Boolean values, some numbers. You can see longitude, latitude. So you can see a lot of different data there. So we're gonna use Logstash to extract the CSV data out into those particular fields, stick it in Elasticsearch in those particular fields, telling Elasticsearch that, you know, this is a longitude, this is a latitude, you know, various, these are booleans up here. So we'll be able to tell Elasticsearch what all this kind of data is, so that when we go and visualize it in Kibana, we can do some nice, pretty sort of like maybe a geo map, some graphs, some pie charts, and things like that. So so that's what we're about to do right now. So in that file we've got there, you'll have that data. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to read in that data file. We're going to convert that CSV file into values. We're going to use some filters here in Logstash. We're going to use the CSV filter to read each line of that data file and would say, okay, it's a CSV file and it has these fields in it. Then we're going to do some mutations. So we're basically going to say, okay, this is a lat long, this is geo coordinates, this is a boolean, this is a number. We're going to assign some like essentially data types to those things, and then we're just going to stick it in Elasticsearch, and then later on we'll create some dashboards in Kibana. Right. So you'll see there's I think in the dataset there you'll see there's a config file there, and we'll just run through it for now. And feel free to like open up a new text file and call it, you know, publictoilets.conf or something, and just type away here. But basically, you know, here's our new input. We're going to use a standard in here, and we're going to have like a type here, which is basically if you were like had a few inputs and you wanted to like, you know, separate what type of input they are. That's what we're doing here. We're saying that this is a type of toilets. That's just an imaginary type. There is no actual type in Elasticsearch called toilets. It's not predefined. We don't have magic toilet passing data. So yeah, we're just calling it that. We're just assigning a label to this data. So essentially assigning a label to this particular data stream, this particular input. So this is one of our filters which we're going to use. You can see that we've added, like, besides this, we've added, this is a complete filter block here. You can have multiple filter blocks. They're just passed in order in the config file. So it won't matter that if we're using a different filter later on, the mutate filter, that it's in a different block. As long as it's in a filter block and it's all proper JSON sort of stuff, that's fine. So we're just basically saying that, okay, all of the messages, all the events, the log messages which are coming through here, they're of the type CSV, and these are the fields which are in there. So we're basically just saying that CSV file, the first field is a toilet ID, the second field is a URL, and next one's a name, address, that kind of thing. We're not doing any like kind of like data type sort of like assigning this as a Boolean or anything here. We're just basically putting labels on those fields in the CSV file. So again, here's our second filter we're going to use. It's a mutate filter. And what we're doing is we're converting some of those fields into different types. So we're saying the toilet ID, it's just an integer, it's just a number. So let's make it an integer. We've got some Booleans there, you know, is there male toilets available, true, false, that kind of thing, female, unisex, that kind of stuff. So we're just like basically doing some defining what the type of data it is for those fields we just created with the CSV filter. And then we're going to write it out to Elasticsearch. So you can see that before we were just doing standard out. Now we're adding two outputs, which basically means each line of that CSV file is going to go two places. The first place it's going to go is Elasticsearch. It's going to be put into an index called public toilets. We're going to use a special template which we've pre-created and baked for you, called Logstash template, to sort of add some structure to that data in Elasticsearch. That's its name, which is going to be stored in Elasticsearch, and some other stuff. We don't need to worry too much about that template stuff at this stage. Let's just say it's a way of sort of like adding a bit more structure in Elasticsearch to define our data, because basically with Elasticsearch, if you just throw data at it, it will just store it no matter what. It doesn't care. So if you want to have some structure, sometimes you might need to predefine that structure, and that's what we're doing here. So at the same time as sending those messages to Elasticsearch, we're also sending them to standard out. But instead of actually just writing the original line out, we're going to write out a dot instead. And the dots filter codec is just sort of a way to, like, I guess, have a progress bar. So, you know, like PV or something like that in the terminal. It just essentially writes a dot for each line which is processed in Elastic Logstash. And that's pretty much our config. Yeah, so... Oh, do you want to? Oh, no. Oh, okay. You want me to type? Yeah, right. So we're going to, Thanks, man. Not a Mac user. We've got our slash. Which one's control? Awesome. So we should have our data somewhere here.
I'll do it.
He's mic'd up. So
I'll do it because I'm mic'd. Okay, so we're going to cd into the toilet map directory. And you can see we've got the public toilet CSV file. So we'll just gunzip that. You can see we have the logstash.conf, the one that Josh ran through bit by bit. We also have this template here that we sort of touched on. We'll actually talk a little bit more about templates later on. You can...
Yeah, so if you look at that logstash.conf, that'll be just basically all that slides which I just ran through. You'll see the entire config there. Should give you an idea. So yeah, there you go. So we've got our input. We're going to just like cat a file into Logstash. We've got some filters in the different order than we were talking. Doesn't matter. Order is irrelevant. They're just processed in order as they go down the file. So you can see we're doing our mutate. We're just basically cleaning up the data file. And this is quite often what happens when you get some random piece of data. We're just like basically getting rid of some white space and control characters and things like that. Because, you know, quite often you get this data and who knows, it's not very clean. So you have to do some like essentially some cleaning steps. Anyone who's dealt with like open data will be familiar with this kind of thing. So yeah, so we're just stripping out some guff out of these lines. Then we're doing a CSV, and basically we're just saying, these are the columns in the file. And as you can see, it's pretty much what you'd see in the toilet map, you know, toilet ID, the URL, that kind of stuff. You can see there we're doing a conditional. All we're doing there is just dropping the first line, because it's a CSV file and it's got a comment line in the first line, which is basically just the, you know, telling you what the columns are. We're just going to drop that line. So that's kind of useful. So, you know, like if you're processing some kind of file and maybe it's got a bunch of comments in there and, you know, they're like, they've got a hash or something as the first character, you can sort of drop those lines so you don't actually get them into your database. So drop is a kind of useful thing to get rid of stuff you're actually not really interested in. Then we're doing the mutate where we basically just assign these particular data types to some of the fields. And basically it's a lot of Booleans and floats and... yeah, and some geo stuff. I think, yeah, we're doing some geo stuff down here. So this config might look a little complicated, but it contains a lot of different elements here. Hopefully hopefully it's pretty easy to follow through. Just essentially mutating some values, defining what the data is, removing some guff, that kind of stuff. It's just generally we're doing all those steps of that you know, reading the data, clean it up, define what it is, and send it somewhere. We're doing all of those steps within Logstash. So Logstash is our real big workhorse in this instance here. So this is how you're going to process the data. If you gunzipped it, you can do just cat. If you haven't gunzipped it, obviously zcat. So just run that command line. Yeah, watch your relative directories, obviously, you know, to define where Logstash is. So
cat it into, if you're in the toilet map, it's down a directory, logstash 211, bin logstash dash f, and then logstash.conf, so you point it at the config file. I forgot about zcat, sorry. Run it, watch the dots.
As I said before, because we define the standard output with dots, that would have normally, if we didn't do that codec as dots, we would be seeing a whole bunch of lines flying past now, which is kind of like boring and just slow, you know, annoying. So we're just using dots. So each dot you're seeing there is a line being processed by Logstash and being stuck in Elasticsearch. If you go back to your Elasticsearch terminal, you might see a few extra lines now appear magically there. So
yeah, so if you jump back to your terminal that you had Elasticsearch running, you'll see here, you'll see there was a .kibana index that got created when we initially started Kibana. And then the next line after that, you can see here, public toilets, that's the index that we just created due to the Logstash running that configuration. There's a whole bunch of other information in here. When you create an index being a data, like a bucket of data, we shard it out so that when you have multiple nodes in a cluster, we can move those shards, and that's where we get some redundancy and some concurrency. By default, we ship with 5 shards and 1 replica, so 5 primary shards and 1 replica, so it actually means we've got 10 shards in total. Has everyone seen a whole bunch of dots? Is anyone not seeing dots? If I had done this config, and I probably would have made some mistakes, or if there was errors, you know, if we when we ran the file, there was something that didn't match all the filters and the patterns and whatnot. Instead of a dot, you'll actually get the error that comes out. So so this one we've obviously played around with. Well, Josh has done all the hard work there, actually. But if you're playing around with the config file, if you've got 16,000 or a data file, if you've got 16,000 records and it's the first time you've touched it, you probably don't want to cat the whole file into it. So the way that I like to do it is I just grab a couple of files, and use that standard in, standard out, start Logstash, and then you know paste those directly in so you can see the output, or just use you know head minus 10 or whatever, tail minus 10 or whatever. Yes.
So that's downloaded that data set into Elasticsearch.
Yep. Correct? Yes.
Yeah. So the
it'll overwrite. Yep. Yep.
So I'm getting no such index errors from Elastic. Is that normal?
Do you want to have a look at that?
Yeah, I'll have a look.
It's normal?
No.
It's not normal. Phew. Is anyone else need a hand? Don't be afraid to yell out. Okay, so I mean that's sort of interesting. You know, dots are not fantastic, but if you are dealing with a massive text file, you don't want to see all the lines. Like, you know, we do a training course where we work with a file that's 300,000 events, like lines, and some people don't put the dots in the config file, and it actually really slows your computer down. Like, you're sitting there. We've had people take half an hour to load, you know, 300,000 lines because they've got standard out repeating things without that dots codec. So it actually makes a pretty big difference. Okay, so we're going to take a little tiny brief detour into interacting with Elasticsearch without Kibana. So before, I just assume that everyone knows that zero refers to localhost. Does everyone know that? It's a literally, when you type 127.0.0.1 a whole bunch of times, that's really good. So we ran this before to just test Elasticsearch and see that it was running. So it's curl defaults to HTTP, but obviously, you know, we're saying connect to localhost and return whatever response, the default response for 9200, which is this. Now, there's this, we have a whole bunch of APIs, specifically there's this one called cat that I'm just going to touch on. But if we run the same thing, you get a whole bunch of endpoints here. So cat is kind of like a really nice, quick way of getting some high-level information about your cluster. So if we do cat indices, for example, we can see that we have the .kibana index that we created earlier. We also have the public toilets index that we just created then. And you can see a whole bunch of other stuff here. I understand that because I've been working with Elasticsearch for quite a while. The cool thing about cat is, you know, there's all these flags that you can pass on. Question mark V is obviously verbose, and we get a nice little heading. So you can see here that we've got 17,000 events in the public toilets index. So there's actually 17,000 toilets, not 16,000. That's a lot of toilets. So I talked earlier about how we create, you know, by default, five primary shards and then replicas of one. Information here about, you know, how big that is. It's you know, 10 meg on disk for that data set. Yeah, so it's created five, so the shards are essentially like sub-buckets, so each of those will hold, so what we can do is we can do cat index, I want to say shards, but I don't know if that's right. Yeah. I don't know why it's not alphabetical. So you can see here, these are the five shards. Now what's also interesting for an ops person, and like me, that's why I'm going to talk about it, is we have the various states here, and you know we've got a P for primary, R for replica. Now, why would we have the primary started, but the replica unassigned? Sorry? Yeah. I mean, it makes no sense at all to assign a primary and a replica to the same node because yeah, I mean, that's not really fault tolerant, is it? So in this case, what will actually happen is, you know, this is a non-existent shard. It is something that we want to assign, but we can't because we don't have a second node. If you start up another instance of Elasticsearch in your laptop, you would actually get those assigned, and the data would be shared across multiple nodes, which is pretty cool. I have a little nice little thing here because I like to be nice and green. And then if we run that cat shards, so all I've done is dynamically, this is the cool thing about Elasticsearch, you can just change all this stuff on the fly. You can change replicas on the fly, you cannot change shards. So if you create an index with 5 shards, to create an to re-shard it, you actually need to re-index into another index with, you know, 10 or 100 shards. Yep.
So it didn't actually do anything to set the sharding policy.
That's the default. Yeah, it's implied. I think we mentioned it in the Elasticsearch.yaml config file. Yeah. If we don't, that's really bad, and we should. We'll actually go into the next data set. We sort of touch on a little bit more about that. So maybe that'll answer your questions. But so here specifically, I've just said, you know, I don't care about replicas because I've only got a single node. Set it to 0. And everything is started, and then if we do curl 09200, indices. So before we actually had a health of yellow, because yellow means that the replica's unassigned, and now it's green because everything's assigned because there's no replicas. That's just, you know, a nice little thing. I like things to be all nice and ordered, so. If you go back over here into the log, you can actually see where I've set the number of replicas to 0 as well. So we do log these sorts of things. So if someone decides they're going to set replicas to 0 and then you lose data, you can come in and find out what's happened. That's some operational sort of stuff. The CAT APIs are really, really handy for looking. It's probably more operational. There's heaps and heaps of other APIs. Let's actually do a brief search. So we're connecting to 9200 again. We'll specify the... that's wrong. 9200. The index. And then this question mark Q equals Geelong. And we may actually want to wrap that in quotes. So you can actually, this question mark Q is just like a shortcut for search. And if you run that, you get back a whole bunch of JSON that you probably can't read. Because by default, we assume that we're talking to a machine. So if anyone missed that, before, if you just do Q Geelong, it'll spit back, you know, any documents that match, that have the string of Geelong in there. If you add this and pretty to it, it returns a little bit more human readable. It's not human readable though, because you kind of got to scroll up all through this, right? So just a really, really quick introduction to dealing with Elasticsearch on the command line, using curl, doing a real basic search. It's probably not what you're going to be doing all day, because that's what Kibana's for. We're actually going to take another detour, because I like detours. So we actually have this app called Sense. And Sense is kind of like curl, but it's browser-based. Does anyone know Postman? Yeah, the plugin for Chrome? It's really awesome. So we have this thing called Sense, which is kind of like Postman, but specific to Elasticsearch. And it's actually a Kibana plugin. So go back to your tab for Kibana. And then we want to run Kibana again. I'll just type in bin, Kibana, plugin, and I always get this wrong, install Elastic Sense. So we're running Kibana again. We're passing in this plugin argument. So we're telling it to invoke the plugin installer. We're saying, I want to actually install this, and we're passing in Elastic Sense. And then if we actually run that, we try a whole bunch of different things. So we connect to our download site and do this. You can actually, it'll connect to GitHub. So this is essentially a user and a repo. And so you can dynamically install things from the internets. You can pass it a specific file path. So if you wanted to do an offline install, so it's pretty flexible. So Kibana, bin Kibana plugin, install Elasticsense, let it do its thing. Optimizing. I really want to raise a GitHub issue to get this change from optimizing to reticulating splines, because I think that'd be awesome. Okay. Please yell out if that doesn't work. And then we restart Kibana, because unfortunately you can't dynamically load plugins into Kibana at the moment. And then you can see, you know, before we had basically all this, you can see here we've loaded the plugin sense. So it's detected that we've downloaded it and it's installed it and it's reticulated the splines and gone, hey, cool. So now what we're going to do is, per this nice little URL here, go to localhost, let it load up. Don't worry about this stuff yet. We'll get into that. Click on the little, I don't know what that is, little thing. And you can see here it's figured out. It's referring to itself, because then you can actually get back to the primary Kibana app. But also go to Sense. And you've got some stuff here, you know, blah, 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 blah. Welcome to Sense, how to use it. Ooh. Ooh. What's going on there? Oh, wow. That's really weird. Anyway, so it does cool stuff like it does autocomplete. So if you type G, it figures out you want to type get, because there's not that many HTTP verbs. But the other cool thing is you can start doing things like you type cat, and it'll go, hey, you want something from the cat API endpoint. And you can do autocompletes. And you run that, and so you get the same thing. We've seen this, right? So it's just a different way of interacting with it. This is really cool, because if you want to start building more complex queries, it'll actually help you do that by... what is going on there? Anyway. Oh, no, I broke it. It'll actually help you build the query. So it'll do autocomplete. So, you know, if you want to do a match all query or you want to do an aggregation, it'll help build the framework for you to do that. It's really, really handy when you're first getting into Elasticsearch. What are some other... Oh, right. So let's actually go back here and then we'll copy this. You can?
Yeah, so when you copy that entire curl command and paste it in Sense, Sense will just magically convert it to the right format. So,
that is magic.
Yep.
I didn't know it could do that. And control command enter to run it. And it's the same thing, right? It's just, it actually will format it so it is pretty as well, which is nice. And I should note that we use question mark V here. It's exactly the same thing. It's just nice and browser based. Obviously, you do need Kibana running. It doesn't just run by magic. Install plugin. Let me just full screen that. We'll actually install another, later on. We'll install another plugin, which is it may or may not be pointless, but you know, we'll just run through it. Down the back, Josh. Okay, so let's go back into Kibana. We click on the little, I don't know, what do you call that thing? It's an app picker, that's what it is. So we go from Sense, we go into Kibana, and we actually need to do some setting up. So we actually need to tell Kibana, hey, you need to look in Elasticsearch for this index name. So specifically here, we're not working with time-based events. The stack really, like the ELK stack, as it was known, was all about logging. You know, it was about dealing with time-based events. So that a lot of this sort of stuff, like this default pattern here, obviously defaults to Logstash. So we can do public, and then you can see there it should autocomplete, and then you just hit save or whatever the button was, I've forgotten. And it'll connect to Elasticsearch, and you can see here, if we scroll down, these are the fields that we actually created with Logstash. And you can see, oh, hey, look, we cast or we mutated the baby change field to a Boolean, and Elasticsearch has gone, hey, this is a Boolean. We've got GeoIP, which is probably a little wrong because it's not an IP, but you know that's a geo point. And we'll see why that's important later. And if you can scroll down, you can see all that sort of stuff. It may or may not be interesting at this stage. It's probably not. So analysis with, you know, if you put something into Elasticsearch, if you put in a whole bunch of string, like to text, say like the works of Shakespeare, for example, you can, if you put that into a search engine, but, you know, when you're sort of dealing with natural human language, you may not care about certain words and you may want to normalize your data. So what analysis does is it takes things and it does, like it decapitalizes everything. It takes out what we call stop words, so common words like the, and, because you're probably not going to search for the, right? I mean, it's a really common word, you don't really care. So that's what analysis means. And you can just, you know, you can actually set that in the template that we talked about. So you can set specific fields and say, you know, we call it non-analyzed or a not analyzed field is the raw field. Yeah, yep. So this sort of stuff, you know, when you start playing around with the mappings and saying, you know, you want to analyze and not analyze it, there's a certain assumption that you know your data set. And then when you're dealing with it, you know how it's been mapped in the back end. We go into mapping a little bit more. Oh, okay, we're going too slow apparently. Anyway, so has everyone done this, gotten into the index? So for everyone else, if you just want to click on Discover, and you can see a whole bunch of data here, right? So these are the events that we pushed in with Logstash. And you can expand an event, and you can see these are the fields that were broken, you know, the fields that got broke out and created in Elasticsearch, and the values. There's a whole bunch of stuff in there. Oops. Yeah, that's the one I want. So some interesting things, you can actually, over on the left here, if you find a field and you click on the field, it gives you some really high-level stats of, you know, 68.4% of documents have an accessible mail field of false. So around 70% of toilets in Australia aren't accessible for, don't have mail accessibility. Adequate mail accessibility. And you can, you know, drill down more into all of those. Right. Oh, we jumped way ahead. Or I ordered these slides wrong. So we've done this. We've defined our index. We've set it up. We've gone to Discover. So now we're actually going to build what we call visualizations. So from here, click on Visualize. And you can see there's a whole bunch of visualizations here. You know, we've got pie charts, as I mentioned earlier. We've got line charts, bar charts, a whole bunch of other sorts of stuff. We want to build a pie chart because it's easy and it's just getting used to things. In Discover, you can actually build specific searches. So you can narrow your view of your data down and then save that search and build a visualization based on that. We're not going to get into that. So we actually just want to go, oh, wow, that was really quick. Sorry, visualize pie chart from a new search. Oh, okay. It's just figured out that we want to jump straight into here. So here we're actually doing, this is a total count of all the events, so that's kind of pointless for a pie chart, right? You can't really tell anything about that. Oh, wow, where's that? No, get out of there, slide. Oh, anyway. So we probably want to do something like split slices. So we can say, well, let's split slices on a term. Drinking water sounds kind of interesting, right? So it's either going to have drinking water or it's not. So it's a bit of a binary choice. And funnily enough, this is the result.
So it looks like most toilets have water, but not recommended to drink.
Yeah, basically. One sort of annoying user interface thing is we don't actually put the numbers of the percentage in the slices of the pie graph, which is kind of annoying. You've got to mouse over. There's a feature request to add that. But that's all you do. And then you just go save, and then we'll call this one public toilet. Water pie graph. I find it really useful to append the name of the data set, because if you've got multiple data sets and you've just got, you know, pie graph one, pie graph two, it makes absolutely no sense. Let me go save. And this actually saves it back into Elasticsearch in that .kibana index that we created before. Do you have a question or a problem? Yep, okay. Yep. So we want to go to split slices, and then we do a terms aggregation, which is literally saying, you know, look in the data for a specific term. I'll run through it again. Split slices, aggregation, terms, and then you get these extra things, and we'll go field. Well, actually, let's do state. So if you scroll down, you can see here, Kibana's kind of tried to be smart and separate things out. You've got numbers. These are all Booleans. You've got numbers, and these are strings. So it logically groups your data. You can type in there as well. It'll jump to wherever it is. So state, I can't remember how many states and territories there are in Australia. There's like 7, I think. So by default, we'll pick the 5. We'll pick the top 5. Let's change that to 10. Hit this little green apply. And so here, this is actually probably a little bit more interesting in that we can see the breakdown of public toilets by state. So New South Wales has 30% of the toilets, which kind of makes sense because we've got, well, I say we because I'm from Sydney, sorry. New South Wales has got a lot of people. Victoria's coming second with 23%, blah, 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 blah. So did everyone do something like this? You probably can with some scripting, which is a bit more advanced. So with the Boolean that I showed before, it was 0 and 1. It's not obvious that it's true and false unless you understand Kibana. We actually used to use true and false, but we made some changes in Elasticsearch to Booleans were restored as T or F, but we changed it to 0 or 1. So it's, yeah, it makes sense under the hood, but not on top. So, I mean, that sort of stuff, look, yeah, that's a bit of a shortcoming. Totally. Totally, yep. Okay, so save that one. And that's really quick, right? This gives you an idea of, doing a brief terms aggregation. I'm going to save this one, and I'm going to call it state breakdown pie. Save. Right, so this is what we want to try and build. And I'm kind of conscious of the time because we've got about half an hour, so I'm sorry, I kept talking too much. So this is what we want to build. And it kind of looks complex, but it's actually not that difficult. So here we've got a map, we've got a pie chart. This is the pie chart we just created, so you've already got a head start. This is actually a bunch of metrics. So you can do just metrics. So, you know, things like sums, mins, max, nth percentile, all that sort of thing. Here we've got a bar chart. And this is but a little bit more readable. So go back into, so we want to create new visualizations, which we do by clicking on this little plus button here, new visualization. So start by trying to build a map of the toilet location. So I'm going to run through it. So it's actually a tile map, not like that's what it's called. So new search again. So this uses OpenStreetMap, by the way. If you don't have access to the internet, you won't get a map. You can actually define your own maps in here. So we actually have people that are building, like, use the product for storing like data, game information, like Blizzard, you know, for what's the Blizzard game? WoW, yeah. So you can build a WoW map and plug it in and then use the coordinates of a character in there to plot it on a map, for example. Totally not not useful for me, but I mean, that's pretty cool. So it's already figured out that there's a geo field here because we mapped it as that. So then we just hit play, and then this little button, is like zoom in to fit, or zoom in or zoom out to fit all the data on your screen. And it's a density map, right? Like a heat map, essentially. So you can see there's a whole, there's 4,891 here, you know, blah, 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 blah. So it's pretty cool. You can zoom in, and as you zoom in, it automatically changes, you know, the heat map stuff. Really quickly, if you go into options, you can change things like this. So this is a heat map, so you can actually see like a blobbish distribution. This is under options here. And you can play around, you know, there's heaps of stuff there. We don't really have heaps of time to get into it. But has everyone got something that looks kind of like this? Yep, cool, let's save that. Oh, why did I do that? The cool thing about it is you can actually just go back if you go, you know, if you do the wrong thing, because it saves a whole bunch. The URLs are really, 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 really long because we store some of the state in the URL, which means you can go backwards very easily if you stuff something up and you save something you shouldn't have. Save that, public toilets, map, save. We've already got the pie chart here. So we next one, we'll go through accessibility by state, which is a bar chart. So we'll create a new one here. We want a vertical bar chart because you can't do horizontal ones yet. New, I gotta remember how to do this one, actually. So we want to split the bar chart by, we want to do a terms aggregation on the state field, and then change that to 10 because it's a nice round number. You could put it to 7. Oh no, that's not right. We want to do X axis, sorry, not split the bar. 10. So this is kind of exactly like the pie chart. It's just it's shown a different way. So you can see, you know, there's a whole bunch in New South Wales. You know, we saw that with the pie chart. So the interesting thing that we're going to do here is you can take this, which is an aggregation of the data, and then you can run another aggregation on top of that. So you've got your bucket here. We want to go down the bottom, it says add sub-buckets. We then want to split the bars, and we want to do this thing called a filter. And this is where you can actually start typing things manually. So you can do like a text filter or something like that. So we can actually do, we know there's a field that is called accessible mail, and we, given that it's a Boolean, we're actually, you know, we create a filter called zero. Doesn't make a lot of sense because we're only filtering on one thing, right? But if we run that, you can see how that's changed. But it's not that actually that useful. So what we're going to do, there's a little bit of manual here. So we've got accessible male, false, true, accessible female, false, true. We click save, and that's actually a little bit more interesting. So you can see the number of, you know, I might have done that the wrong way. You can see how it's broken the data down a little bit more, right? It's actually getting something that's a little bit more useful and informative. So we'll save that one really quickly. We're going to be around for the rest of the week, so please come and have a chat to us if we're going too fast or we're actually going too slow because we've got another data set to go through. Anyway, so now we've actually got a bunch of visualizations. We go to the dashboard page. We click on this little, the little circle with the plus, and you'll be able to see all the different visualizations that we've broken down. So essentially, you build a dashboard out of a whole bunch of different visualizations. And this is all dynamic, so you can click and drag things, and then the data resizes. Move this one up here. Drag that around. It's too small still. Come on. This is the problem of presenting my resolutions really high, so that's a little better. You can scroll down. And if we had time, we could add in the metrics one. But you kind of get the gist, right? You build your little visualizations to represent a part of the data, and then you build a nice big dashboard that you can throw up on a screen and give people access to. Save the dashboard, public toilets.
Is there a
way to lock the colors? Yeah, there is, but not in this version. Yeah, so 4.4, which came out yesterday, solves that. Yep, but we just didn't have time to roll into it. We already had enough problems, as you saw. Okay, so you may or may not have gotten all of this. It's okay if you didn't. We can put the slides up, and I'll add in, so for this specific one here, well, for all of them, I'll put in a slide showing, you know, how to build that visualization with all the configuration options on the left there. So there's a bonus pie. Does anyone know how you could inject this into, if you go to the visualizations page, how could I inject this into a dashboard? Anyone? Anyone looking? Can anyone figure out how to do this pie chart? Sorry? this isn't dynamic. This would be really cool if we could turn this into a pie chart. There's actually a markdown box, and you can just insert random pictures. And so you can put this one up, and then, you know, if you actually bought a pie and cut little slices out of it, you could turn it into some cool pie chart, but I like this. I got told that pie charts are irrelevant. This is entirely relevant. Okay, so mindful of time, we've got another data set that we're going to play around with, Australian data events. I found this because I'm kind of weird, and I thought, hey, dead people, that's pretty interesting. And this is the URL to the data set. It's not entirely current. I think there's a couple of years, the later years missing. So it's got a whole bunch of data going back to like the early 1800s of disasters, right? A whole bunch of information. In here, you've got things like numbers, you've got strings, you've got geo information as well. So we talked earlier about the template and defining your data in Elasticsearch. So Josh mentioned that you can just throw data in Elasticsearch and it'll go, hey, that's cool, I'll index this. The downside to that is that sometimes what can happen is if Elasticsearch receives a field that's a string, or it receives a field that's an integer and goes, hey, I'm going to set this as an integer field. If for some reason someone passes in some data that's a string, it's going to reject it because it's going, well, this is an integer field, I can't put a string in there. Obviously, the best way to deal with that is to make sure your data is normalized. But you can also say, well, I don't know whether it's going to be a string or an integer. So you define it up front. So Elasticsearch has this thing called a mapping, which is essentially like a schema, right? You can set all these different sorts of mapping types. We only have IPv4 because that's a Lucene problem, because we don't have big ints. But that's coming really, really soon. You can do various arrays. You can actually do geo points. You can also do shapes as well, so like polygons and whatever you want to do. So obviously, if you know your data set, applying a mapping is the best way to make sure that when the data goes in, it's going to adhere to that, so that when you build your dashboards or your visualizations, or even just running searches, it's going to be known results. So really quickly, let's go back to Kibana, and it might actually make sense to open Sense in a different window. So I forgot that we changed the index name, so it should be public toilets, not toilet map. I'm sorry. I've really failed. Oops. Oh, it even fixes my typos. So we can actually see what the mapping is for a specific index by this is the index name, and this is the mapping endpoint for that index. And if you have a look really quickly, you can see things, you know, like access female and male that we played with, you know, with that last set of graphs, was saying specifically that it's a type of Boolean. And you scroll down, what else do we got? Where's the geo information? Here. So that's what it looks like for the latitude and longitude. It's just a type of geopoint, and Elasticsearch knows what that is and can deal with it appropriately. So basically, you just pass in this GeoIP, and then it's not immediately obvious, but it's GeoIP.location, and then Elasticsearch says, oh, that's an array of two values, and I know that it's a geopoint, so that when it saves in Elasticsearch, Kibana can read it out correctly. Toilet ID of type long, a whole bunch of other information in there. So now let's go into the disaster events directory. You can see we have this mapping.json. So someone asked earlier about the, you know, how to set the number of shards. You can actually do that in a mapping. I've used this, you can set best compression, which is a way just to obviously increase the compression of the data that's stored in an index. And this is, it's pretty much exactly the same sort of thing. You know, I've got a whole bunch of fields, you know, this is a long, we're telling it not to analyze, which is, you know, don't lowercase, don't remove spaces and stop words and all that sort of stuff. And then you keep going down here, there's a whole bunch of information. This doc value is true is a way to take pressure out of your memory. We won't go into that. Come and have a chat to us if you want. There's a fair bit in there, right? So what we can then do is fix up my typos. Oh, no, that one's right. So basically, we're going to use curl to load this file into Elasticsearch, and this here is the, because we're uploading a mapping, we actually have to give the mapping a name. So this isn't actually an index name, it's a mapping name. It's a way of identifying the mapping, so that if, for example, we were in Sense, you could just you know, get AU disaster events underscore mapping, and it knows what it's doing. So run that curl. You should get acknowledged true. That means the mapping's been put up. I'll leave that there for another minute. So the cool thing, what we also did is we uploaded the mapping. So right, so we set the schema so that when we start putting data in there, we know what everything is. What it's also done, though, is Elasticsearch has also created an index called AU Disaster Events with that single shard already. So it's ready to receive the data. That specific index. Yeah. An index. Yeah, so you know before how Josh talked about templates? Yeah, so a template is a mapping that applies to multiple indices. So if you have a look in the Logstash template here file, you can see this match public toilets. You could use, you know, public underscore star, and it'd apply to any index. So we passed in, we actually, without knowing it, we passed in a mapping before with Logstash. So you can see you can manage it manually, or you can manage it through Logstash. All right. Now let's process it. Am I in the right directory? Yes, I am. So we want to do logstash bin, we want to zcat, do I have zcat installed? All right. Use disaster events. And this is a JSON file. This isn't a CSV file. I've actually grabbed it from the API and done a whole bunch of stuff to it just to normalize it. Logstash bin logstash dash f logstash.conf. Run that. Sorry. Does it need to be a .z? Nah. I don't know what I'm doing with zcat, so I'm just gonna unzip it. If you know how to use zcat, which I don't, you can figure it out. Don't have time, sorry. Ooh, look at that. Sorry? Yeah. Okay. So I've been playing around with this data for a while. I built it under logstash 1 something, and you can see because I've upgraded it, I'm using a deprecated setting. So that's kind of nice if you upgrade and you're using something that you shouldn't be. Elasticsearch will tell you about it. Logstash will tell you about it. This one's really quick. There's not a whole bunch of, there is a whole bunch of dead people, but there's not a whole bunch of events in which dead people were made dead. So this is what we did. Process the data. Now, this is what we're going to build. We may not get through all of this because we're running out of time, and that's my fault.
Going into lunch, so yeah. We can probably hang back if people want to finish doing the visualizations. We can help with that.
This is what we want to build. So you know, we've got a free text here. Free text is actually just a markdown box, which is really, really just handy. You can actually use it as like a directory of dashboards or other sorts of things. We want to build a whole bunch of different metrics here, blah, 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 blah. That's what it's going to look like. And I'm sorry, I'm not going to run through it because we are running short on time. But I'm pretty sure I've already got... I don't have this one. Sucks. I have this one on my cluster that is on the internet. But let's just imagine that we built this and hey, congratulations everyone, you're all awesome. We can run through this. If someone wants to run through this at lunch, please come and see us. You know, we're happy to chat. So we installed Sense before. This is the plugin that I was talking about earlier, the cloud plugin, the tag cloud plugin. I'm not going to install it. I mean, this is exactly the same install with Sense. Here I've just pointed it at there's a free text field in there, and it's just gone in and said, okay, well, what are the most common terms? And not surprisingly, shipwreck disaster events happen quite a lot, right? So it's highlighted that. You may like this. You may think that, you know, something like this is nice and pretty. I actually asked for this a while ago because it is not, like, it's useful, you know, it can be really, really useful. But I got a bit of pushback because it's apparently not very, I don't know, doesn't really tell you. Like, it just says there's a whole bunch of shipwrecks, but apart from that, it doesn't give you any sort of, well, how many more shipwrecks? It's just bigger is better. Totally, yeah. Yep. Yeah, see, yeah, you're right. People do die from a lot of ants because I didn't remove those. So if I had have removed that you wouldn't see that. That's that analyzed process. Sorry?
Sounds quite dangerous.
Yeah. Yep. So, I mean, it's just interesting, right? You can just look at that and go, hey, look, there's a whole bunch of shipwrecks. If this was some actual, you know, other interesting data that might be useful to, say, a manager, you can point out, you know, like power loss. Sorry, GitHub, you know, your power outages are your main problem. We need to fix our power. Okay, so we're almost at the end. So I can hit play again. we've kind of flown through the last parts, and I apologize for that. But hopefully, we've sort of given you an idea of how you can use the various tools to, you know, monitor or process different sorts of data. You know, we use Logstash to store it and to do aggregations. So all those visualizations that we built, as I mentioned, they're just aggregations that run in Elasticsearch. Logstash does all the nice manipulation and the processing and pushing into Elasticsearch, and we built some really quick GUIs with Kibana. Kibana does not work with anything other than Elasticsearch. We've got an engine there that does some cool stuff. You can use Grafana for anyone that deals with that. Grafana interacts with Elasticsearch, but it's, you know, you can't build completely useless tag clouds like that with Grafana. So, you know, we're very big into the community. I actually got this job because I hung out on IRC in the mailing lists way too much. So thanks to my previous employer for not firing me for that. This is a whole bunch of resources. All of our docs are up on the website. We have meetups specifically one in Sydney. I'm trying to start one down here. If anyone wants to talk at such a meetup or host such a meetup, please come and see me. We have forums where I still hang out way too much, but I get paid for it and everyone's happy with that. All of our code and the source of all the docs is available on GitHub. There are issues with documentation. There are probably issues with the code. PRs are more than welcome. We have a really bad habit of hiring people that write really good code and then commit it. So, hint, hint. We also have IRC. Again, I hang out there way too much, but that's cool. Bunch of Freeno channels there. There's also Beats, but not many people hang out in there, unfortunately. So what we're doing with this cool stuff is we would like you to find a data set, do some cool stuff with it, and we will give this to you. A couple of examples. Josh started playing around. There's a Vic accidents data set in GitHub and on the USB sticks. It's pretty complex. If you can process that and give us something cool, we'll give you this and we may offer you a job. But there's corporate transparency, the data set that was published recently, which is around donations to political organizations. There's a whole bunch of, health expenditure in Australia. You can actually take Wikipedia, basically all of Wikipedia, put it in Elasticsearch and run some analysis on it. Please do, come back to us. I know it's Thursday, but come back to us tomorrow with something cool, and we will give you cool stuff. That's where we'll put everything up. We will fix a few of those issues. We will put a PDF of the slide in there. We are around, as we mentioned, for the rest of the week. Come and hassle us. There's swag up the back corner there. I have a whole bunch of stickers. Thank you for sitting through that and coping with my mistakes. Thank you to my lovely assistant here. Take a bow, Josh. No. Thanks.
Thanks, everyone.
Do we...